All right, it's time to get started. Welcome to the lectures. It's a great honor to introduce Professor Solomon Marcus. Professor Solomon Marcus is a member of the Romanian Academy of Sciences. He published in a variety of fields from mathematical analysis, mathematical and computational linguistics, computer science, poetics, humanities, philosophy, religion, all kinds of comparisons. He published over 50 books in almost all the languages and over 400 research articles in almost every country. Quite a prolific writer. He also was a founder of the computer science in Romania. But from my personal perspective, Professor Solomon Marcus is my professor. For those of us who did our PhD under his supervision, he inspired us with the stature of a great mathematician who devoted his life to mathematics. I have been thinking about what have we learned so far from him. What are the Solomon Marcus axioms? Axiom one, be an automata theorist. Automata, grammars, and linguistics are major sources of mathematical insight. Axiom two, be multidimensional interdisciplinary. First of all, interdisciplinarity for him is the type of interdisciplinarity in which you are also, you made also world-class contributions to at least one of the disciplines in the interdisciplinary component. And multidimensional means mathematics and sciences, mathematics and arts, mathematics and mathematics across areas of mathematics, but also mathematics and philosophy, and mathematics in society. Axiom three, be most theoretical and most applied, which means on the scale of theoretical and applied, work at their extremes, most theoretical and most applied. And finally, axiom four, be a mathematician of continuous discrete mathematics symbiosis. John von Neumann proposed a research program towards a new theory of information and computation for the living cell. In his unfinished work, he envisioned a new theory where the most cultivated part of mathematics, calculus, mathematical analysis, and the most refractory part of mathematics, combinatorics and logic, are unified via a concept of thermodynamic error. Professor Marcus has world-class standing in both continuous mathematical analysis and discrete combinatorics. John von Neumann also said in the 50s that mathematics was then already too wide for a single mathematician to know more than about a quarter of it, referring to himself, of course. My guess is that Professor Solomon Marcus knows in 2008 at least one quarter of mathematics as well. So these four axioms, being an automata theorist, be multidimensional interdisciplinary, be most theoretical and most applied, and be a mathematician of continual discrete mathematics symbiosis, are also the axioms of John von Neumann. Professor Marcus is the type of mathematician from the tradition of great mathematics of John von Neumann. I'm very happy that he is here today at Brown to give us some lectures. So.
Thank you, Professor, and I want, dear colleagues, to tell you how honored I am to be here, because everybody knows Brown University is a mark of quality. Now, what I am trying, because we are in the month of August, to give some lectures as less technical, as little technical as possible. but to try to convey you some ideas, some very controversial ideas. And I begin now with this topic, the loneliness of mathematics.
Who knows how to
use it? Is this clear, yeah? You can improve. Loneliness of mathematics may seem strange because everybody knows that mathematics is universal. What loneliness if it is universal? Well, it may happen, and you will see that loneliness and universality may go together. And not only they may go together, that sometimes, in some respects, loneliness is a condition of its universality. So, you have there two words, loneliness and mathematics, and mathematicians. Loneliness, I will speak about it in details. But what about mathematician? There is no general agreement about what does it mean a mathematician. But if you take it in the maximal possibility, calling yourself a mathematician is an audacity that not many people with full knowledge in the case can afford. And then I remember Norbert Wiener, who could, by, you know, his famous autobiography entitled I Am a Mathematician. But look, another mathematician, Paul Halmosch, also with a good reputation in mathematics, but one class less than Norbert Wiener, when he published his autobiography, he put the title, I Want to be a Mathematician. So, we consider the mathematician in his very hypostasis. The way to this target, this is very important, the way to this target is an adventure which deserves to be told, even if the target is not actually touched. About me, I could say, for almost 60 years, I try to be a mathematician. I will tell you, I'm afraid that they will be 11, but you know, the list is open, and everybody could add a new one. 10 aspects of the loneliness of the mathematician. And you will see that he, the mathematician, is partly responsible for this situation. Look, the first one, as a matter of fact, is chronologically the first I met in my life. And most school students reject mathematics. This is tragic, but this is a reality. This happens mainly when they are 11, 12, 13 years old. And later also. They find no motivation, no satisfaction in learning mathematics. Adds a question. Why do you learn mathematics? Answers are of the type, because it is required, imposed by our teachers. Or, because we have to pass tests in this respect, examinations. Or, because otherwise we are not accepted in the next class. Rarely, very rarely, we get the answer because I enjoy it, or at least because I like it. This about the students. Now, what about the teachers? What about the teachers, the textbooks, school textbooks, school mathematical schedule and programs? Most school mathematics textbooks are unfriendly, sad, if not directly annoying. This is a big failure of mathematical teachers, authors of the respective textbooks and of the programs behind them. These authors did not find the way to reach children's curiosity, children's understanding, children's need of an immediate motivation as a reward for the effort they are required to make. The presence of the ludic element, game play, as an essential ingredient of the learning process, especially in mathematics, is almost totally ignored. So, there is a crisis of communication between mathematics teachers and most of their students. Another face of the same problem. There is a huge gap between the true mathematics and the school mathematics. School mathematics consists mainly of procedures, tools, formulas, and algorithms. It is dominated by the imperative style. Show that. Prove that. True mathematics consists of questions, doubts, guesses, tests on particular examples, attempts, failures, mistakes, intuitions, ideas, analogies, aesthetic criteria, findings, and finally taking the form of theorems. And new questions, of theorems and new questions. True mathematics is dominated by the interrogative, not by the imperative style, and need a cultural and historical context. Now we move to another aspect. Governance. The bureaucracy of science and other possible sources of financing require from mathematics and from mathematicians something which is against its nature, to show its utilitarian function by immediate applications of practical interest. Beginning with the old Greeks, mathematics developed mainly under the stimulus of human instinctual desire to know and to understand the world. Gratuitousness was its main source of success. Main progress of mathematics came from considering it a game and a play. The deepest applications and connections with the other fields and with the practical life came just as a consequence of this attitude. Mathematics should be accepted with a status like that of music. The therapeutic function of music is well known, but nobody proposed to evaluate composers according to the therapeutic qualities of their works. The main force of mathematical creativity comes from considering it for its own sake.
But it's not true that composers also don't get very much funding?
Excuse me. We postpone for the end the call. I am afraid that I... There is a huge gap between the visible face of mathematics in mathematical scientific monographs, treatises and research mathematical journals, on the one hand, and the internal life of creative mathematics, on the other hand. The public appearance of mathematics, of mathematical research, is mainly interested to put maximum possible logical order in presentation and maximum possible rigor, giving in this way the possibility to check efficiently the correctness of the proofs and the validity of all statements. However, the logical order is often very different, if not the opposite, of the order in which ideas emerged in the creative process. The very rigid scenario, definitions, notations, theorems, proofs, consisting in chains of syllogism, hides the very nature of mathematical research, where deduction has a marginal position, while main attention is paid
to
intuitive aspects, links between apparently disparate facts, individual examples, analogies of all sorts, pictures, abductive steps, conjectures, and various kinds of attempts, taking only finally the status of theorems. So we saw already the level of school, the level of school students, the level of students, the level, the university teaching level, the level of research journal, and now the level of the public perception of mathematics. Most intellectuals see mathematics as a useful tool. Sometimes they accept it as a useful language. But rarely is mathematics recognized and understood as a cultural enterprise. And this is reflected also in the bureaucracy of science, where cultural departments are completely different from science and technology. There are claims, very strong claims against the cultural status of mathematics and in general of science. What are these claims? Culture is related to human being. Mathematics is concerned with abstractions having nothing specific to humans. Culture is contributing to the national identity of a people, while mathematics is the same everywhere. It has nothing specific to a national community. Culture is concerned with stable values, such as Sophocles' tragedies, Beethoven's music, Shakespeare's theater, Rembrandt's paintings. Mathematical theories, like scientific theories in general, are always replaced by other theories more comprehensive. Scientific values are provisional, they lack stability. Obviously, I reject all these claims and I leave to you to find the reasons to reject all of them. Look, in the same order of ideas, claim, today scientific language with its highly mathematical structure is a danger for humanity. Who says this? The famous English philosopher George Steiner in his book Language and Silence. Silence in the world of human communication by language, the modern scientific language, create the silence. I don't know.
There are two buttons.
Huh?
There are two buttons.
Oh. You see, silence is created by the modern scientific language. It stops communication between humans because, in view of its highly mathematical structure, it becomes incomprehensible for most people. This is a claim by George Steiner, a famous philosopher translated in all languages. And another a French contemporary philosopher, Michel Henry, published in 1987 a book, La Barbarie, Barbarie. You know what does it mean, barbarie? La Barbarie means here the contemporary scientific language, mathematics. Mathematics is a modern name of barbarie. You could not believe that this could be a claim in our time. It is. And not only it is, Michel Henry has a very good reputation in everywhere, including in my country, Romania. So, La Barbarie means here the contemporary scientific language, considered like Steiner, anti-human in view of its increasing distance in respect to the everyday natural language. You can see the basic mistakes they make here. They put identity between natural language and human language. So for them, artificial language, particularly programming language, they are not human because they are different from the natural one. As a matter of fact, they are more human than the natural language because natural language is to a large extent biology, while programming language has 100% human creativity. A very important point, very frequent question: could we live in absence of mathematics? The answer we give is yes, but how you prove it? But look, human civilization could not be conceived in absence of mathematics, but this fact remains hidden for most people. This is a tragedy. Take only Pythagoras' theorem. It made possible the study of trigonometric functions, which made possible differential and integral calculus, the study of periodic phenomena, all of them essential in engineering and technology. We could say with no exaggeration, human civilization could not be conceived in absence of Pythagoras' theorem. But how many people realize the richness of mathematics existing behind space travels, meteorological satellites, computer tomography? It was a Nobel Prize in medicine for a work very rich in high mathematics. Nobel Prize in internet, most of Nobel Prizes in economics. How many people realize the mathematics existing in all these things? How could we evaluate the great profit obtained by contamination of human way of thinking by the mathematical way of thinking? Most people ignore how much is mankind indebted to mathematics. You see, this means beyond mathematical results, there is a mathematical way of thinking which is universal, and we will come back on this point later. Again, about public perception of mathematics. Public's cold respect for mathematics has a very sad source. It does not come from its understanding. On the contrary, it is based on the conviction that mathematics should be an intellectually difficult performance or exercise if most people are not able to understand it. So, it deserves respect. But this type of respect turns often in doubts and suspicion. Many school students and their parents wonder why should learn mathematics so many students who don't want to become mathematicians. Stupid question. From similar people come from time to time the requirement to reduce the place of mathematics in various non-mathematical university departments, including also computer science department. There are, I know very many situations of this type, claiming for computer science without mathematics, or leave mathematics as little as possible. And now a very delicate point. Here you will see in what sense mathematicians themselves are responsible for their loneliness. When non-mathematicians ask a mathematician to help them in solving a certain problem, the mathematician will usually change the formulation of the problem in order to give it the full status of a mathematical problem. Most people are not able to formulate their question in a mathematically acceptable form. But very often the non-mathematician will feel frustrated, having the impression that his problem was replaced by another one, which is no longer his problem. Goethe, in his conversations with Eckermann, is touching just this point, expressed his feeling by a happy analogy. I am sorry, I had the quotation in German, but I will give him. Mathematicians are like French people. You tell them something, They translate it in their language, and after this, you understand nothing. And here is the source of the ironical definition of mathematics, according to which a mathematician is that people capable to solve any problem except the problem you need. Many engineers, they invented this joke because they had this frustration. At a mathematician, another joke expressing the same feeling. What is a mathematician? Is a person whose answer to a proposed problem is characterized by three features. It takes a long time, it is precise, and it is useless. It is enough to take, for instance, the four-color, famous four-color problem. In its initial formulation, how could you color a map in such a way that no neighbor countries have the same color? But this is not yet a mathematical problem. You have to precise what does it mean, neighbor, what does it mean. And in order to give a mathematical form to all these things, obviously you need a very strong modification. As this happens with most problems, people are rising to mathematicians. According to the general belief, mathematics is concerned with the real world. In fact, the game of mathematics takes place in a fictional universe. Humanists wonder when they read this because they are convinced that literature and art are the only field dominated by fiction. Not at all. Mathematics is really developing in a fictional universe. And this is perhaps the main reason why some people feel frustrated when their problems become mathematical problems. Look, I give you here a very, how can you convince even a child who is only, let's say, 9 years old that mathematics is not directly concerned with the real world? Here is this. I tell you the problem. You have a bread. You eat today half of it. Tomorrow, what half of what remained. And each day, you eat a half of what remained from yesterday. After how many days you will finish the bread? This is a mathematical formulation. Children's answers. But you did not tell us how big is the bread. But I am afraid that the knife will no longer work after 3 or 4 days, and so on. And only one or two or three of them will never finish. But you already here you see the discrepancy between reality and mathematics, because everybody knows that a bread may be as big as you want, you will finish it after a finite number of days. Mathematically, you finish it never. So this is a very important feature. And you can see that even the Euclid's elements, they begin with two statements. I call point what has no parts. I call line what has no
side.
Yeah. obviously these are fictional objects. The Nevels, nobody saw such objects. From the beginning, it is clear that you are placed in a fictional universe. Mathematics is alone in the world of various disciplines. It is ineffable. There is no general agreement about how to define it. Mathematics is victim of various stereotypes. One of them is to put it together with physics, excuse me, it's a mistake, physics and chemistry. But mathematics is not a natural science. It is not concerned with a specific slice of the real world. According to another stereotype, mathematics belongs, together with physics and chemistry, to the field of exact sciences. However, economics, for instance, is not less concerned by the mathematical approach, so it deserves equally to be considered an exact science, and nobody considers it. A third, more subtle stereotype is to consider mathematics just as science. Obviously, it has many aspects of a science, but it also has many aspects of an art. You remember the book by a famous French mathematician, but the book was published in German, Mathematik, Kunst und Wissenschaft, Mathematics, Art and Science. A book by Halmosch is telling the same, mathematics as an art. And most famous mathematicians stress the artistic nature of mathematics. Obviously, it also has many aspects of an art and of a philosophy. As a matter of fact, the borders between science and art, between science and engineering, between science and philosophy, are today much more questionable than yesterday. There is no satisfactory definition of art or of philosophy, too. We mathematicians are not able to explain to common people. Are you able to explain to people in the street what is your job? And people confuse mathematicians with engineers, with accountants, with computer scientists, and with logicians. But even this, what does it mean to be a computer scientist? I don't think they understand. They reduce. As you reduce mathematics to capacity to calculate, the similar confusion is for computer science. We are in a clear crisis of identity. Americans are right in considering mathematics aside, but having connection. I had a paper in a mathematical the proceedings of a mathematical conference called Mathematical Connections in Art, Music, and Science. So mathematics aside, alone, like music, alone. Arts means visual arts, and science, natural science, social science, and so on. First advice I received when I became a university student from my professor was, make tabula rasa of school mathematics. This means ignore school mathematics. But don't take, this is what I added, but don't take it ad literam. What does it mean, make tabula rasa? This means the real mathematics is not what you learn in the school. This means. Obviously, it does not mean to ignore the basic notions concerning trigonometry and so on and so on. what I observed, what most people don't imagine, a possible relevance of mathematics beyond physics, engineering, economics, and computers. Most people don't imagine that mathematics is more than calculation. And most people don't imagine that mathematics has still some problems waiting to be solved. You don't have enough formulas. Why do you need more, some more formulas? And I speak about intellectuals, not functional literacy. Intellectuals. And so I understand, to come back to the first, to one of the first phase of loneliness, French people create this description of what means school mathematics. Mathématique recette de cuisine, or in United States, cookbook mathematics. This is school mathematics. Know-how, algorithms, procedures, answer to how questions, not to why questions. And so Heidegger comes in attention, Wissenschaft denkt nicht. Science does not think. Incapacity to understand that mathematics is not concerned only with numbers and quantities, structural, but also with qualitative structural aspects, with patterns and forms. As a matter of fact, zero and one are not, are in computer science, logical symbols rather than numbers. Turing extended computation for numbers to abstract symbols, but people ignore this. Even many computer scientists. But now, as a matter of fact, mathematical language, main source of the loneliness of the mathematician. People, when they think of, about mathematics, they think about, they are afraid of formulas, equations. So, we need to remain a little to make the anatomy of what does it mean, mathematical language. And I distinguish here 10 components. You see, third, words from natural language, predominantly English, used with their meaning in natural language, like consider, propose, introduction. Then, words are also from natural language, but used with specialized meaning, distance, filter, open, closed. Third, symbols other than those in one and two, but provided by natural language as artificial symbols like A, B, C, X, Y, zeta, pi, omega, gamma, delta, alpha, beta, gamma, etc. Then, four, symbols other than the first three types. 0, 1, 2, 3, inclusion, belongingness, piano sign, disjunction, conjunction, negation, integral, equally, etc. Then, five, expressions, relations, formulas, equations formed by symbols of the previous types. Discrete pictorial representations, graph, matrices, diagrams, continuous pictorial representations, curves, fluxes, computer programs, symbolic systems like the tech printing programming language according to the Greek techne associated with the Latin texere. And this derivative, like latex, that according to some commons regulates the printing of the mathematical text. And then ultimately the oral component of mathematics. So you have see here such a richness. Linear and polydimensional, discrete and continuous, natural and artificial. But I claim most important are the first one. The natural language component is the main component of mathematical language, as Paul Halmos stressed in his famous booklet, How to Write Mathematics. Keep a balance, 50-50, between the natural and the artificial component in a normal mathematical text. And you can see this is just what does not happen in children's textbook of mathematics. You may have 10 pages with no word. Natural component is thrown away. It's a caricature of the real mathematical language, because in absence of words, you cannot develop reasoning, the mathematical reasoning. It may be clear that mathematical language is not the same as axiomatic deductive language or formalized language, as many people think. What I told you, school mathematics does not respect just what I told you now. Mathematical language is polydimensional. Force linearity diminishes the heuristic function of mathematical language. Different components are associated with different historical period. You may understand here why children who are 11, 12, 13 are becoming divorced with mathematics. Because the mathematics they learn is the mathematics where for the first time the word theorem appears. It is just the great moment, historical moment marked by Pythagoras, in contrast with the pre-Greek mathematics. And this, no attention is paid to prepare the introduction of deductive mathematics, of proofs and theorems. And the same age, 11, 12, 13, is the age when they move from mathematical language identified with the everyday language and mathematical language with its artificial component. They first time begin to use X, Y, Y formulas. The historically speaking, this means a Galileo-Newtonian moment. So, this is why they are in divorce, because people who write all these textbooks either are ignorant or don't pay attention. By negligence, they pay no attention to these very delicate transformations. Now, it is very important to understand, you see, 9 components of the mathematical language are visual, graphic. Only one is oral. Obviously, mathematical language is mainly visual, and you can validate a mathematical statement only in its written form. Then why is the oral component so important? Why are we teaching mathematics? Speaking, because The oral component is auxiliary but essential. It transgresses the linearity and distributes the accent. In by oral component we can bring a lot of motivations and comments which are difficult in the written form. We can distribute the accent to point out what this is the most important thing, this is very important, this is less important. The written form has a tendency to put things all of the same level of importance, and this is not the reality. In modern science, now, here is an important thing. You see what I write on the last line? I write, mathematics is not only a tool, it is a language, but mathematical language includes questions, history, references, problems, examples, comment, guesses, theorems and proofs, corollaries, relations to other fields of observation. Articulates logical, sequential and non-sequential, intuitive, analytic and synthetic, experimental, experiential logic. Natural mathematical language is organized on three levels. Syntactic, according rules of combination. Semantic, with reference to meaning. Pragmatic, concerning the relation with the user. And you will see that, unfortunately, the teaching of mathematics is almost completely oriented toward the syntactic aspects and very little oriented to meaning and pragmatic aspects. Semantics of mathematical language, this means what is concerned to meaning, is of two kinds. Like in natural language, you have additive semantics and integrative. What does it mean? Additive semantics means that the meaning of a statement is obtained by concatenating the meanings of the components. But it happens sometimes that this is not true. In natural language, we have what is called idiomatic expressions, where the meaning is integrative, not additive. But you have idiomatic expressions in mathematics too. For instance, if you take integral from A to B, from the function fx dx. You see here, this is like an idiomatic expression because dx here is a purely symbolic notation. It does not mean differential of x. The juxtaposition between fx and dx does not mean multiplication. So, you see, it is just everything in this notation is a metaphor. It's something which keeps similarity with the finite expression, you see, when you define the integral, you work with these expressions, and this expression is just this finite sum becomes this sign from A to B, if what is here from 0 to 1, and fx dx, dx is to remember this, fx is to remember this, this is to remember this. This is a way mathematical notation respects an analogy, a principle of analogy, in order to help us to understand how was it obtained by a limiting process from the first Psalms. And why this is a analogy is very important in to understand how similar is the mathematical language with the natural language. In the mathematical language you have more than in natural language what linguists called anaphoric and cataphoric relations. Anaphoric means what is sending back. Cataphoric, what is sending ahead. And in mathematics, you see, you can realize how anaphoric it is if you cut the first 10 pages from a mathematical book, you understand nothing. If you cut the first 10 pages from a book of geography, it does not damage at all. So this shows how strong is the solidarity between different parts in a mathematical text in respect to other types of text. I would say in mathematics, in the mathematical language, you need very long context. And this may seem strange because, you know, when we simplify things, we say, well, in mathematics it's based on dictionary definitions. Everything is defined from the beginning. While in natural language, things have a strong contextual dependence. But what is the reality? The reality is that if you remain only at the initial definition, you will understand very little from a mathematical text. The contextual dependence in mathematics is very strong, as I expressed, but in another way. The dependency of long context is valid in both natural language and mathematical language, but for completely different reasons. I cannot deepen here this, but this deserves much attention. So I wrote also here, cognitive and creative metaphors. One example, it was the integral, which is a metaphor of the finite sum. But one can show, and this would deserve a special lecture, that all basic processes of generalization in mathematics are essentially creative metaphors. To give only one to suggest, only one suggestion. I am sorry. Look. Take the crisis of irrationals, old Greeks. The impossibility to measure the length of the diagonal of a square, let's say one, and here it was no available number to tell the length of the diagonal. And then there began the adventure of irrational numbers, adventure that it took 2,000 years. But it was a metaphorical adventure. Why? Because the problem was, like in any metaphor, we are looking for an entity which if you take its square, you get something similar to what is n, no, entity, let's say entity in respect to its square, is like n in respect to n square, where n is a positive integer, a natural number. And you see here, the problem was, you have here an analogy, but the analogy is in respect to something which not yet exist. You are looking for such an entity. Like in a usual metaphor, you say, this girl is a flower. No, the flower is a metaphor of the girl. The flower, the metaphor is referring to an already existing entity, the girl. While here, the entity does not already exist. The metaphorical process in respect to an entity emerging just under the metaphorical process. And this metaphorical process took 2,000 years to reach the form we know, given in the 19th century, where the status of real numbers was clarified and all these things became were converted in a conceptual level. So these are metaphors, cognitive and creative metaphors, looking for a conceptual status. When the conceptual status is reached, then the creative nature of the metaphor disappears. So I try to suggest only what richness exists in this mathematical language about which people are so much afraid because it is not understood. But then, after saying so many good things about the mathematical language, you have to raise the basic question. Is mathematics only a language? The answer is clearly no. And I give you here a list of different hypostases of mathematics, each of them very important. Their order has nothing to do with their importance. For each of them needs a rich comment. What is mathematics? It is a field of knowledge and research. It is a science. It is an art. It is a useful tool. It is a language. It is a way of thinking. It is a catalyst of some transfers of ideas, methods, and results. Like, for instance, only one example, how the concept of entropy was transferred from thermodynamics to information theory. It would be impossible this in absence of mathematics. It is a discipline taught in schools and universities. It is a way to understand the world. It is a social phenomenon. It is a cultural phenomenon. It is a game. It is a way of life. And I think firstly to Paul Erdős. It is a way to understand our own thinking. I could say in many respects, mathematics is describing the architecture of our thinking. It is a part of our spiritual life. It is a philosophy. It is a possible form of pathology, like Eret Bishop stressed in a famous paper, The Schizophrenia of Contemporary Mathematics. It may be a fashion. It may be a means for intimidating and terrorizing people. Like in a theatrical play by Eugenio Ionescu, he is using the language, but similarly you can use the matter. And it is always sometimes a form of snobbism. And the list is open. See the richness of mathematics. For each of them we could give a special talk. Look, for instance, only for the mathematical way of thinking. The mathematical way of thinking is a whole typology of different types of thinking, and no mathematician excels in all of them. The separative thinking, the capacity to separate form from substance in various phenomena. The step-by-step procedure, maybe this is the most important, and this is what was brought by appearance of theorems. This means, what does it mean, step-by-step procedure? This means, you can say, in any field you proceed step-by-step, but the difference is that in mathematics, this step-by-step procedure is explicit and not implicit. And at every step, it is explicit how much you are based, you are using the preceding steps. And in this way you explain, you can understand the moment where the artificial component appears, when you need to supplement the natural component with some artificial prostasis. The deductive thinking, the inductive thinking, the deductive, I will not insist here, it is very familiar. The inductive thinking is not only what we know from the school, move from particular to general, because it was shown by great thinkers that the inductive thinking is self-referential. This means the way, I quote here two names, Nelson Goodman and Karl Hempel. For instance, when you trace experimentally, you get a finite number of points describing an experimental phenomenon. And then you, by a curve, you unit all these points. But the way you choose this curve can be chosen in infinitely many ways. The way you choose it is dictated by some previous representation existing in our brain, and ultimately it is based on abductive thinking. This means abductive thinking is related to the construction of hypotheses. You see here, this is one of the main shortcomings of mathematical teaching. We have a theorem, we teach how we prove it, but we never teach how we find it. To find a theorem is a completely different thing from to prove a theorem. And this is the most creative part, and this exercise, the exercise to guess. To guess, look, I put it at the end, but it is very important, guessing, to develop the capacity of guessing. This means the capacity to imagine, to build hypotheses, interesting conjectures. And this is the way most theorems are born. And this fact is completely neglected in mathematical education. The binary thinking, the triadic thinking, the analogic thinking. Banach said that when he was asked, what does it mean a mathematician? He said, a mathematician is mainly a person able to make analogies between concepts, analogies between theorems, analogies between theories, and analogies between analogies. metaphorical, combinatorial, probabilistic, recursive, algorithmic, transfinite, special, guessing, topological. So you see, the typology of the mathematical way of thinking, how rich it is, and I think this is the strongest virtue of mathematics by which it acquires its universality, because the mathematical way of thinking is important not only in mathematics, it is essential in all situations in our life. We stop here, and excuse me if I spoke more than scheduled.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Yes. You just now you gave us a very large number of definitions of properties of mathematics, but there's a question. Do we have a single definition? Can we say a definition, mathematics is, and this tells us the whole thing, and it's a single definition? Because Phil Davis and I had some meetings about that, and we haven't come up with a single definition. So do we have a single definition, or is it just
no. There
are a large number of problems,
you
can always add new ones?
I collected from literature various definitions. Many of them captures some, for instance, it was an article, Mathematics, the Science of Patterns, by Steen. René Thom proposed mathematics is a science of forms and of their evolutions. And so on, you find another definition in Wikipedia, and it seems to me each of them captures some aspects, none of them, and as you can, by what I told you, I think I proved that no short definition of mathematics is possible. No statement of two or three lines can describe mathematics. And this is a situation of most things which have a high complexity. For instance, I give you another example. Do you know that there is no short definition of the game? What does it mean, a game? No short definition is able to capture all aspects, all possible aspects of a game. And this was the challenge of by Wittgenstein. So I think we should refuse to try to look for a short definition of mathematics. If we want to not risk a stupid definition, very limited, for instance, to say science, mathematics is a science of numbers. Mathematics, I saw even recently in many articles belonging to people working in theology, in philosophy, they say mathematics is a science of quantities. No comment. But they need this simplificatory description of mathematics to make easier their job to show, because their axiom is our job begins where the job of mathematicians stops. So we are interested to show that it stops very early in order to have enough much available for our job. Or to claim that in mathematics there is no room for why questions. In mathematics we only are looking for how questions. This is not at all true. We can give a lot, for instance, Gödel's theorem. Gödel's theorem, let's say, it shows how things happen in a formal system. But if you take the theorem proposed by how is called this who introduced information algorithmic information complexity,
Chaitin.
He tried to give the following explanation of Gödel's theorem. You cannot, in a formal system, you cannot cope with a statement whose information complexity is higher than the information complexity of the axioms of the respective system. It is an explanation. You may accept it or not, but it is a way to answer why things happen like in Gödel's theorem. And I think in mathematics too, you have a sequence of alternation of why and how questions. And this never stops. Because every how answer leads to a new question and so on.
Thank you, and I agree with you about the comment that it's difficult to have a definition.
Other questions? Yes.
I had a very practical question. Yes. You, at the beginning of your talk, spoke a great deal about what I'm just going to call math phobia. So children not liking math and sort of what are, can you speak on some things that people in the mathematics community should do or should they do to try to account for
that? Could you explain me what is the question?
Oh, sorry.
I did not capture
the... How can we be constructive about the criticisms that teaching mathematics in schools is done so badly? What should we do?
Oh, but you know, in order to answer this your question, we have thousands of papers. All this international congresses of mathematical education are coping with this question. Recently, it was in Mexico. This is not a question to which we can give us. I personally, I published, I think, more than 100 papers and two or three books where I am coping with this question. So, things are very... because, you know, I give you only one suggestion. For instance, you may wonder why are we are not able to improve the mathematical education of children, because here is the source, the main source of all things I told you is in the way mathematical education is done to children who are 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And the problem is that, you know, if you take the bureaucratic face of this problem, you realize that in order to solve such a problem, you have to take in consideration the children, their parents, their teachers, the central bureaucracy of education, governments, so on, the publishing houses which are publishing the textbooks, and it is very difficult, if not impossible, to cope with all this, because one of the main source of failure in education, not only in mathematical education, is the fact that most parents are not able to educate their own children. For instance, I did not speak about this, but you may see that many of the great mathematicians received their basic education from their parents. The main teacher of mathematics for Paul Erdős was his mother. And I can give you a lot of such examples. So it is very difficult to cope with all these social components of the process, even they don't agree what I told you about what is mathematics by its real nature. Many of our colleagues don't agree with this. And in Europe, for instance, we have many difficulties with the European Commission, which is monitorizing the cultural process in all European countries, and they require from mathematics to plan, to say exactly what practical problems will be solved in the next 2 or 3 years. So this is social awareness in respect to all these problems is far away from our understanding of the respective problems. Very difficult.
All right, we should think.